books, there is, to my knowledge, heavy stress on what's called, I think in both books, the last days, the days of judgment. In the Bible, it's the object of the final book, which is the book of Revelation, which describes an end to human history. And I know if I didn't bring a Quran with myself, but if I had the Holy Quran here, if I had an index, I would be able to point to many verses which describe that period of the last days of the days of judgment. So my question is, I would like to ask you how this end to history, this period of judgment, is seen today by Islamic scholars and by the Islamic scholar that you yourself are. That was my first question.
One question, one. One question.
The other question. You'll have the other one as well.
All right.
We'll have the other one.
The question I think you have heard very, very clearly about the Bible speaking about the end of days, Yawm al-Qiyamah. The Quran speaks about Yawm al-Qiyamah, the last days. There is some kind of common ground between the two. And the question was, I think, what does the Quran say? If our brother, he says, if he had a Quran with an index, he might have been able to give those references. Here it is, I have a Quran with an index, and it speaks about the hereafter, or last day, doomsday. It speaks about it here, the day of judgment. As a matter of fact, one third of the Quran deals with this subject. One third. Heaven and hell, hereafter, day of judgment, all these verses when they're put together, about one third of the Quran. But today it looks like bulk of the learned men, they don't want to make people, you know, terrified. Because it is quite a terrifying thought, you know, that your doomsday, my doomsday, is very close. You see, the realistic person, he doesn't go into wanting to know when, today, tomorrow, next year, 5 years' time, 10 years' time. Because I feel and I believe that my doomsday, my end of time is the moment I close my eyes, is the moment I die. Finish. Why should I worry whether this earth is going to last another 1,000,000 years or not, or another 1,000 years? How is that going to help me? Suppose I knew that tomorrow, 12 o'clock, the earth is coming to an end. How will that help me? What will I start doing? Will I start saying, hallelujah, 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 subhanallah, subhanallah, what am I going to start doing? When I start making out a will, when the will be used, what am I going to do? So the Holy Prophet Muhammad, I think, he puts us all to rest with regards to that problem. In one of his sayings, hadith, he said that if you were to plant a fruit tree today, and the sure knowledge reaches you that tomorrow, 12 noon, is doomsday, Qiyamah will be established. Everything will be wiped out. What must you do? He said, plant the fruit tree. God will reward you for that. But tomorrow, 12 o'clock, you know, it will take 7 years, and the coconut palm will take 20 years before it bears the coconut. You know, that 20-year tree, 20 years it takes. Mango trees, from seedling, 7 years. But you plant it, you're supposed to plant today, and tomorrow, 12 o'clock, it will be all wiped out. He said, plant it. In other words, behave naturally. This is the message. The message is as if you're going to live for that moment. You don't have to starting, you know, going down into prostration, now making sujood, subhanallah, 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 glory to God, glory to God. How is that going to help you now? All your life, what you have been doing, and now all of a sudden you say, for half a day, 8 hours, you say, subhanallah, subhanallah. No. Behave naturally, normally. And I think because of that philosophic idea, that the Muslim is not overawed with Qiyamah. Let it come, we must be ever ready. At any given moment, we know we are in tune with our Lord. This is is the prerequisite. Any given moment, Malak al-Maut comes, the angel of death comes along, says, take my soul, take my soul. I should be ever ready at any time. I don't have to start getting worried. The Christians have been, you know, false ideas have been creeping up. Immediately after Jesus, people, they didn't want to buy properties. They didn't want to do farming. Even today, the Jehovah's Witnesses. You know, in my country, in South Africa, the Jehovah's Witnesses, they are all aspiring to buy the land around Stellenbosch. You know, there's wineries and breweries, you know, you have those all those vineyards. They are waiting. The most valuable land in South Africa is around there in the Cape. They are waiting for doomsday to be established so that they will rule and they'll have all the land. For the moment, they're not interested. They won't build orphanages, they won't build hospitals. See, it creates that type of mentality. Anytime now, so what must you do? Why must you work? Why must you improve? No, Islam says, you work as if you're going to live forever. Carry on. And when the time comes, you go. But the subject is dealt with quite extensively in the Quran, that it's a reality. It is no joke. Hell is no joke. See? And when you read that, it does have an effect on your life. You'll mend your life. But the one with the index is here. If you want to make references to it, you may. Heaven, hell, hereafter, and day of judgment.
I have, in fact, three questions. Two pertains to your present lecture, and perhaps one is a very odd one. My first question is that the last testimony does indicate, or I will rephrase my question, does the last testimony indicates about any messenger, or it is indicated by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that any messenger in any form will come after him? My number two question is, what will be
the... One question at a time, please.
Okay.
I think it's only fair. You see, this is a very old machine. It's 70 years old. You pose three questions, and by the time I start answering one, I think I answered the lot. Then so you see, this guy is now, you know, he's trying to get away with it. So therefore, I said, one at a time, you asked a question, I can digest that, and I can give you, if I have some knowledge, and then when your turn comes again, I will answer again. So there is no reference in the Quran with regards to the coming of any messenger, another prophet. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Khatumun Nabiyeen, is the seal of the prophets, the last of the prophets, and there shall be no prophets after him. That's the message in the Quran. That is the message that 1,000,000,000 Muslims have understood.
New Chairman and dear auditor, I have a question about a prophecy of the Old Testament found in Isaiah 53. There it speaks of a servant who will come and bear our transgressions, be smitten by God, and whose sufferings we will find healing for our transgressions. In other words, forgiveness of sins. So my question is, whose person does it speak of, either Muhammad or Yeshua, that we can find transgressions through, and who is able to forgive sins? If it's God alone, my point is that it's only through an incarnation of God that we can find forgiveness of sin, which this verse is talking about, this servant who is bearing our sins.
See, if the term that is used, that the servant, then at the same time, our brother says that it will be an incarnation of God. That means God himself coming down, taking human form. Now, God can't be his own servant. I don't know whether you can see the contradiction there. God comes down to earth and he's his own servant. It doesn't make sense. How can he be his own servant?